So this is called, I don't know, three famous couples in history, and this was done as a suite. And it came in a case with these, and these are basically museum placards, you know, or whatever, gallery placards. Mm-hmm. And it had, I didn't have it shipped here, a beautiful embossed certificate of authenticity signed, but it's just stunning, right? And so this has been restored, and it doesn't have. It doesn't have those aspects. And you can even see, like this one, which is 42 of 150, as they're sort of pressing off of the plate, you'll get slight variations, right? Because it is a mechanical process, right, of pressing. And so like this one has it, and this one has it. And when they looked at it, and this one really does not have it. And so, notionally at least, every single one of these Dali looked at and said, good, I'll sign it, or bad, I won't, right? And so there's a process. The first thing is like they prove the artiste, which is the artist proof. Mm-hmm. So they do the lithograph plate, they print it, and he looks at it, and there's the things called the bat, which is, I don't speak French, but it's bon à tirer, which is good to pull, and that's the approval for the print, and then they start doing these. And then so you would see these things, like there's some videos, we'll just see Dali in his studio, and he's doing stuff, and he's got two assistants, they're putting him in front of him, he's looking at him, and he, you know, signing, he's looking at him, signing all the... So that's the sort of the process line. We'll go here. So this is from another suite of, so you know, here's Adam Eve, and there's another, obviously, Garden of Eden, right? So this is a different series. You can see the acid piece on it, the signature sort of changed. But this was a larger run, of 1,000. And it was a series from Famous Loves, and I think we had more. This sculpture, we call it, Space Element, iconic imagery from Dali. It shows up in so many places. So there's a very famous painting, The Giraffe on Fire. It's got the space elephant on it. There are just many, many places where you will see this.
Now, were these done duplicates as well?
Yeah, and so this is a number of albums, I know. Okay. Yeah, it's 328 of 350. And so it's the same thing he did, you know, he makes the casting and then he approves it, right? And then it's, you've got a forge. Original sculpture was like fabulously bejeweled, like, you know, precious metal piece that was, you know, who knows how many gazillion dollars to make. And then he authorizes certain additions. And I think this one, there's like this patina and two other patinas.
That were offered?
Yeah, that were made. This one I really love. It's just cool because this is like there's sort of a classic.
It's very iconic.
Yeah. The juxtaposition, like the sky, the thing, but the other piece of it is that the animals are in a place that doesn't make any sense. And it's fascinating because, you know, he worked very quickly. Because the whole surrealist thing was to not interfere with the subconscious as you, like, you have something and you're supposed to go quickly and sort of not correct it. And this is the Freudian aspect of his thing. What's interesting here, like, just from how this works, so this one is a number one and it's 70, right? And if you come over to this side, I think if I have this right, I'm right. So this is the same series, but this is, this was like after the numbered run went, he put his, and you can see it's written back, it shows up as backwards. He put on the plate, they scratched in this stuff, and then they ran additional printings, but it doesn't have a hand signature, and it doesn't have a number. So you can see, like, as a scarcity question, and also, you know, that one set the tone in this in black, but like, they sort of, they move in gradations of scarcity and rareness, and that's how some of the value stuff works on it. Cruising over here, this is fascinating. So this is Bird Paradise. He'd never been to Hawaii, because he flew in an airplane once and he said he'd never do it again. He always took ships, right, between Paris or Spain and New York. And he did that without ever having seen it. And so somebody asked him, he's like, well, I don't need to go there. I know what it looks like. But so look again, here we are, the roads, like the people, it shows up again. And in this one, so this is I'm imagining an artist approved, like artist proof. Mm-hmm. And what that means is he looked at this to make the determination of if the plate was good enough. So it wasn't, it's before the numbering took place. It's like mm-hmm. the thing. And I believe that on the back of this one, if I'm remembering correctly, and I know it's true of the Surrealistic Flower Girl, is the his official archivist was Albert Field, who did the catalog resume, which is sort of the official guide. His signature's on the back of a couple of them, where he had, you know, he personally looked at them because, again, all of these issues there. And what you see, the other important thing is these crutches, a huge recurring theme in all the way. So, and he's sort of, you know, pondering back, and again, here's the road, right? Once again, the road, but he's pondering, I believe, you know, the great inventions and inventors and how they went about it. He was so erudite in terms of mm-hmm. art, right? He could make references that were so, you know, as deep as you could go, you know, he would take you there. But yeah, so Leonardo was obviously somebody who mm-hmm. dissected bodies and did all of these things, and sort of the other piece was the connection between art and commerce and mm-hmm. business, right? Which, you know, Dali was a businessman for sure. And now this is another one of the, this one is from a series called Five Famous Americans, and that's Longfellow. I'm going to take you to my personal favorite. And it's not because it's a little hard to describe. So these two, this is the second lithograph he ever did. And this is called Christ of St. John on the Cross. And there's an extremely famous painting here. And of course, here it is, the robes. This is all this. But what this is the first time ever, like in a major artistic way, somebody had the position of Jesus below the viewer, as opposed to above. And it is a very important sort of artistic statement about the relationship of, you know, people to religion, and it's, you know, it's not totally hierarchical. And so it's interesting, and I also, these two, this is a weird thing, they're not totally unrelated, so these are called the Christ of Gala. But what's interesting is, if we had the right 3D glasses, and if you were standing about right here, they would converge and you would have a 3D image. So this is one of the ones where he did a visual. So I just, and it's put a super like important, and this actually, the, I probably have a picture on my
phone. These are very late works too, aren't they?
These are very, 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 very late. Very, very late, 80s, exactly. This is 1951, and so it's early, and this was done near here at some level because the model for this was a stunt double for Johnny Weissman. Tarzan. And I have a picture of it, you know, from one of the Dali books. So literally, that the model for this was here somewhere, like in the Hollywood area. And he did that, and then he made the painting. So really,
that's a great story.
Fascinating. This one, just from a color perspective, is just cool. So this is Don Quixote, and 1964, and this is an artist approved, and it is an actual one. But a bunch of things happen, and you can see once again, here it is, the road, the people, all of these things, right? It's just, it's this recurring theme. There is the same thing, that little castle piece that you can see right here. Right, there it is here. It just shows up over and over. In 68, somebody reissued it sort of in an unauthorized way. And this is a black, and you know, this is a black and white one. And then the ones that are in sepia are the less rare ones. And then there was just a huge amount of fraud for a long time. It got renamed and all of these things. And so it's a lovely work, and you sort of it was taken advantage of in an awful lot of ways commercially, because it was like. And the other thing is, this is like one continuous squiggle. Like the whole thing is one continuous. That's not an easy, like, to create that movement. So he was like the talent. You know, people don't think he, because he was so whatever, that they don't sort of recognize that his draftsmanship was extraordinary. And so he could do anything, and then he chose to do what he wanted. Like, he, you know, there you can just find Dali's where he's doing the masters, right? Nothing, you know, it just wasn't challenging to him. It's like, you know, that's technique, and I want to do representation. This is a kind of famous one called Elfin Royale, and this, it's again an EA, so it's then breaking on number. And this thing here, which is the crest, was like just a model on a piece on a door, like a little, you know, thing. They just took it and made it into the royal crest. This is, he did a series on Hans Christian Andersen's fables, and so this is the one from The Girl Who Trod on the Loaf, and here you can really see the burning. It must have not been framed particularly well. This is from a series of stained glass.
I like this one.
And again, actually, you like Paradise Lost? Yeah, yeah. And so again, a crutch shows up. And now we'll take you to the freaky to freaky land, right?
We go to the Pentagruel.
Yeah.
It's a forbidden zone.
Yeah. This is the Pentagruel. This is the original case. It's 25 lithographs. It refers back to the book, which is Gargantua pamphlets, Gargantua and Pantagruel from the 1500s. Rabelais, who in France is like Shakespeare. I mean, he's a bat, you know, a canon. And he was also these images, which are so sexually disturbing. They're not much different than the ones that showed up in the pamphlets for this in the 1800s, well before Dali. So this looks like, oh my God, where did he come up with this? Mm-hmm. It's not that far off. And the whole allegory thing is that, you know, these giants went on these crazy adventures and did all of these things. And, you know, Pantagruel, who's Gargantua's son, winds up becoming a humanist. But it's an allegory about the Reformation and fundamentalism. And like, if you believe those stories, why wouldn't you believe these crazy stories I'm telling? And that's sort of the thing. And Rabelais and Pantagruel, Rabelais and Dali sort of engaged, obviously, across 500 years, but in some kind of dialogue together. And he really had a very personal view of how important Rabelais is, and, you know, and went on and on about him. And so this is that one. And here, is Woman of Flame, and the drawers, and the drawers come in, right? And that's the Freudian thing about where people keep their secrets. And this shows up in lots and lots of Dali pieces. And then you've got crutches, right? Which, again, show up there. This one is Gennakis, and this is called The Laurels of Happiness. And this is like a very early, because the lithograph that was published is color. It was done in the limited editions. This is a black and white one. So the magazine of the Surrealist is called The Minotaur. That was the official magazine, and he drew the cover. And this sculpture is based on that illustration of the cover of the Minotaur. I think it's in the 30s, like 36 or something like that, when that happened. And this is a pretty famous one, Transcendent Passage. It's one of his later ones, but obviously it's getting at mortality and things. And then this one is, I think, from the Decameron. So this is like the fiance of the king. As I said, I'm not an art historian by any stretch of the imagination. And the reason I now know a lot about it, which is kind of funny, is because I was trying to figure out after I bought, after the fish was on the hook and they reeled me in, I wondered what I got. had to try and figure out, you know, is it real? How does it work? And so I had to, you know, do a lot of research. Fortunately, I lived next to the Library of Congress, and like I really could do that in the National Gallery. So thank you to our federal institutions and museums. Mm-hmm. It really helped me learn, and it's just fascinating. And also, of course, I now, 2 years ago, I couldn't have told you anything about this stuff, right? Like, and so it's just, it speaks to how good it is for people to spend time with art and like look at it, you know, think about it, look at it, and see other things, and then the onion starts to peel, right? And you just get more. Thank you.